floor. And then the curtains would go up, and there would be a collective gasp as the lights and the scenery on the stage transformed the darkness into a city of twinkling lights, and the fantasy of the Nutcracker would begin. This sense of anticipation is what Advent is all about. The extraordinary thing that is about to happen, the thing you and I have been anticipating and preparing for, is matched only by the extraordinary moment right before it happens. That moment is Advent. This morning we began with a reading from the book of Baruch. Baruch was speaking to the people of Jerusalem after the destruction of their city with a message of encouragement and hope. And then roughly 400 years later, Zechariah proclaims that very same message in the canticle we read. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel. He has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors, and he has remembered his holy covenant that he swore to our ancestor Abraham. Zechariah is giving thanks for God's continued favor, with thankfulness and joy for God's deliverance. This is from a father who in his old age had probably lost all hope that his wife would ever conceive a child. Zechariah had been visited by the angel Gabriel, who told him that not only was his wife going to have a child, but that his child, with the spirit and power of Elijah, will make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And then we come to today's gospel. Here we are, several more years later, listening to the proclamation by that very same child, Zechariah's son, John the Baptist, now a grown man, a prophet, living in the wilderness, a man who we're told lived off of bugs and wild honey, crying out from the wilderness, preaching a baptism for repentance, warning all who heard his voice it was time to clean up their lives. In Judaism, baptism isn't just for ritual cleansing or the forgiveness of sins. It's also a way to prepare for a closer relationship with God. This is exactly what John wants the people to hear. He's telling the people to clean up their act so that they can be in right relationship with their Creator. John knows that their choices have separated them from God. They need to reconnect with who they were created to be, the chosen people of God. As someone said in Sunday school last week, John was just the opening act. John's audience was hearing about Jesus possibly for the very first time. They had no idea who this person was or what to expect. As far as we know, this could have been the very beginning of Jesus' public ministry. So drawing from his Jewish heritage, John pulls out all the stops. He uses the most inspirational message he can possibly think of. He quotes a verse from the Hebrew scriptures, from the prophet Isaiah, one that all the Jews would have been familiar with. Another voice crying out in the wilderness. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled and every mountain shall be made low. Like Baruch, Isaiah was prophesying to the people of Jerusalem who had been taken into exile, the very same people who had been carried away to a foreign land by the Chaldeans, a tribe from the southern part of Babylon who had invaded Jerusalem. They not only destroyed the city and reduced the temple to rubble, they also took the Hebrew people into exile, taking them away from everything they had ever known. Isaiah is proclaiming that this horrible time in their lives is almost over. The end of their exile is near. They should prepare to return to their homeland. He's offering them hope, a light in the darkness. The people John was trying to reach may not have been in exile, but they were just as lost, just as separated from God. In Isaiah's time, when a king was planning to visit his kingdom, he would send a courier ahead to tell the people to prepare the roads. In Luke's gospel, John is the courier. people of John the Baptist, people John the Baptist is speaking to, are no different from you and I. Just like the people in that crowd, we continue to make choices that separate us from God. What John and Isaiah are both trying to get across is that God has always been faithful and forgiving. God doesn't turn away from us. We turn away from God. In the beginning of creation, there was darkness. It's described in Genesis as a great darkness that covered the deep void. But then God said, "Let there be light." And that's all it took. God broke into the darkness and there was light. God continues to break into the darkness. God broke into the darkness for the exiled Hebrew people, and again, when God took on the form of a defenseless child, born into poverty, in the midst of a world that needed healing. When Jesus was born, it was not as though God had all of a sudden decided to reappear. It was that the world was awakened to the realization that God was still present. I have a feeling that there are a lot of people just like the Hebrews who feel lost and alone. The immigrants, far away from home, hoping to find a place to raise their children, trapped between the hope for a new life that lies ahead and the threat of violence that lies behind. Or the growing number of homeless on our own city streets. Just recently, I met a young woman. Her name is Keisha. She lives in Lynn Park, looking every day for some sense of safety and peace. If we've ever needed a voice crying out for a message of hope and promise, a message that says it's way past time to get our lives together, we need it now. The question is, can we be that voice? When John Meacham was interviewing George W. H. Bush for a book he was writing, he asked him why he had chosen a life of service. President Bush came from a wealthy family and could have had a much different, some would say, a much easier life. In response, the president quoted the Gospel of Luke. He said, "To those who much has been given, much is expected." That's not a bad place to start. With an awareness that much is expected out of us, out of God's people. After John the Baptist had warned the crowds to repent, to get ready, they asked John what they should do. He told them that they should give out of their abundance, out of the gifts that they had been given. He said if they had two coats, they should give one away. If they have enough food for their family, they should share with those who don't have enough. That message is just as relevant today. The premise is simple. Live responsibly with an awareness of the needs of others. Be accountable to one another and live joyfully, giving from the heart out of thanksgiving for our Lord's love, faithfulness, and abundant grace. God began a divine work when he broke into humanity as a defenseless child. Our calling is not only to be a recipient of God's blessing, but to carry that divine grace forward, to share out of the abundance we've so graciously been given, and to continue the divine work that God began. We are called not only to be blessed, but to be a blessing to others as well. During this season of Advent, as we wait, anticipating that moment when the curtain will be raised, hoping to get a glimpse of the joy of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, my prayer is that we discover how we can be of greatest use to God's people, how we can be the voice in the wilderness, and last but not least, ask for forgiveness with hope that we will be made right with God. May we never forget that we each have a voice, a God-given voice that can bear witness to the certain presence of God and the promise of eternal salvation to come. Amen. I'm going to take a little privilege here and to add a personal note. I think most of you know this is probably one of my last Sundays at St. Thomas. But before I let this opportunity pass, I want to take a minute to thank each of you for your kindness, your love, and your hospitality. I'm coming to the end of probably the longest really. There are lots of days, lots of doctrine and theology that we learn. But the real preparation for ordained ministry, it happens in the church. It happens with you guys. You have taught me as much as I could ever have learned in any book or in any class. The call to ministry is more about discovering who you are and allowing your true self to come to the surface as it is about learning how to put a collar on. It's not a goal to be achieved as much as it is a gift to be received. You have given me the greatest gift of all. You have given me a safe place to discover the true self that I already possess. And I'll always be very grateful. Thank you.